Good evening and welcome on behalf of the New York Society Library. I'm Sarah Holliday, Head of Events, and I'm just here very briefly to welcome you and to mention what an honor it is to have tonight's speaker with us. A New York City native, Dr. Jean Andrew Jarrett holds degrees from Stuyvesant High School, Princeton University, and Brown University, focusing on both English language and literature and African American studies. That makes him the perfect biographer for the iconic poet Paul Laurence Dunbar. Columbia University's Farrah Jasmine Griffin called Paul Laurence Dunbar one of the most influential poets in all of American literature, and 2022 marks the sesquicentennial of Dunbar's birth. Dr. Jarrett is now Dean of the Faculty and William S. Todd Professor of English at Princeton University. In addition to his current book, Paul Laurence Dunbar, The Life and Times of a Caged Bird, he is the author of Representing the Race, A New Political History of African American Literature, and Deans and Truants, Race and Realism in African American Literature. He is also the co-editor of the collected novels of Paul Laurence Dunbar and the complete stories of Paul Laurence Dunbar, among other editorial roles. Before I hand him the stage, I do want to mention that we have copies of tonight's book for sale through our friends from the Corner Bookstore, in print here in the room, or via the link in the chat for those joining us online. Tonight's event is part of the library's Black Literature Matters programming, generously supported by the Florence Gould Foundation. Please join me in welcoming Jean Andrew Jarrett.
First of all, I want to thank you all for coming, those who are here present and also those online. It's an absolute honor to be here. I've noticed that as I've been walking through this library, it's rather charming. It's a place where you can concentrate because, in fact, it's so loud out there out in the street. And so it's a wonderful enclave to be reading and also engaging in intellectual ideas. And so I'm grateful to be here with you. The first thing I'll do is just walk through how and why I conceived of this biography of Paul Laurence Dunbar. I'll talk about the very origins of this project. And I'll also read certain sections. The sections that I've chosen focus especially on instances of reading or his experiences with the Library of Congress or with the development of his own library in his life. And so I think that'll be apropos of this moment, and I think you'll enjoy it. So first of all, why did I decide to write a biography of Paul Laurence Dunbar? Well, if you can imagine, it started off when I was an undergraduate at Princeton University in the last century, if I'll just put it that way. I was a student of Toni Morrison at Princeton, and she had published a book called Playing in the Dark, focusing on symbols, representations of African Americans in American literature. And I wanted to look at the opposite. I wanted to examine how African-American authors portrayed whiteness or how they managed symbolism of universality or various human experiences. And so there were a variety of writers that fell into this genre, but when I went to the library, I couldn't find them because they weren't canonized as we think about African-American literature. One of the very first authors that I was able to get my hands on was Paul Laurence Dunbar. He had published a novel in 1898 called The Uncalled, and it was a rather spiritual autobiography, if I can put it that way, even though it was under the guise of fiction. And it gave me a chance to learn more about his aesthetic, why he was trying to capture this theme of human universality, not only in his fiction, but also in his poetry, which I'll talk more about. And so Paul Laurence Dunbar ended up being a key figure of my junior thesis, if you can imagine. So my junior thesis at that time, and he eventually became a protagonist or a key character in my doctoral dissertation when I was at Brown University. And he, because I transformed my dissertation into my first book, he's in my first book. I also devoted a chapter of him to my second book. And then by then I said, you know what, maybe I know quite a bit about Paul Laurence Dunbar. I might want to see whether if there's a deeper story that I could unravel. And when I was also a student, aside from Toni Morrison, Honor Rampersad was one of my professors, and he's a wonderful biographer. He had published biographies of Langston Hughes, and also later on Ralph Ellison. And he was someone whose attention to the craft of biography appealed to me very much. I was also, according to my training, a literary historian. So I tended to examine authors in the context of history, whether it's intellectual history or cultural history. I also paid attention to how literary works evolved over time from aesthetic and thematic standpoints. And so in a way, if you intersect my training in literary criticism with my interest in literary history, as an archival scholar, I was so overjoyed when I came across Dunbar's letters of correspondence with his family, with Alice Ruth Moore, who he had a rather tempestuous relationship, which we can talk about later. And I decided 14 years ago to write a biography of Dunbar. And so I started at the at Harvard's Radcliffe Institute for Advanced Study. And 14 years later, I'm pleased to say that this biography came out. So why did I subtitle it The Life and Times of a Caged Bird? Well, I borrowed the term caged bird from a poem titled Sympathy. It's a poem that Dunbar published in his fourth book of poetry, Lyrics of the Hearthside, and it was published in 1899. So I'm going to read this poem for you so you can understand the kind of valences in it. I know what the caged bird feels, alas, when the sun is bright on the upland slopes and the wind stirs soft through the springing grass and the river flows like a stream of glass. When the first bird sings and the first bud opes, and the faint perfume from its chalice it steals, I know what the caged bird feels. I know why the caged bird beats his wing till its blood is red on the cruel bars, for he must fly back to his perch and cling when he fain would be on the bough a swing. And a pain still throbs in the old, old scars, and they pulse again with a keener sting. I know why he beats his wing. I know why the caged bird sings on me when his wing is bruised and his bosom sore, when he beats his bars and he would be free. It is not a carol of joy or glee, but a prayer that he sends from his heart's deep core, but a plea that upward to heaven he flings. I know why the caged bird sings. So this poem, which I think is a moving one, it's a kind of an autobiographical representation of Dunbar's life. So that bird that's beating its wings against the cage, it symbolizes multiple things. First of all, bird is also akin to a bard, as in the poet. This is a bird, something that sings its misery inside the cage. Also, beating the bars against the cage also represents the bars of a poem or the melody of a poem. And you see the kind of constraint that the bird is dealing with. And I argue in my biography that this symbolizes how he's wrestling with and beating up against preconceptions about his life. If you recall, he was born in 1872. He died in 1906. He was born only a few decades after the end of slavery. It was at a time when he was going against conceptions of what African Americans could do. And he decided to have a living by his pen, that the word of poetry would enable him to have an impact on the world. But while he wanted to be a great poet, a universal poet, one who could appeal to the variety of humankind, he nonetheless felt that people wondered whether an African American could achieve that literary excellence. And so that was the battle that he was facing in his own life and also in the commercial world. And so I thought that the notion of a caged bird trapped inside of the cage was in a way that symbolic image that I wanted to lean upon for my biography. And so that's why I titled it The Life and Times of a Caged Bird. So what is Dunbar most known for during his career? That kind of inner turmoil, it results in part from he was a great poet or writer of what was called dialect. Dialect was a kind of orthographic portrayal of vernacular English. So it attested to how people spoke in a language of local color, or if you were undereducated. And at that time, he even tried to represent the voices of former slaves, those he came in contact with. The late 19th century was a time when African Americans only recently then had access to formal schooling, and they were only transitioning into being literate and having access to the great intellectual traditions of Western history. Dunbar himself was quite well read, which I'll show you in a moment, and he is someone who nonetheless mastered the voice of dialect. And when people read his dialect, they thought that he was the greatest African-American writer of his time because he had this authentic tongue that people understood. But at the same time, he was wrestling with, how could I be so successful in writing in dialect, but yet at the same time, I want to be this great poet that was akin to many of the Victorian or the Romantic writers of the 19th century. And so he actually spent more of his time publishing poems in formal English about nature, love, and the various relations of humankind. Only a fraction of the time, maybe 30-40% in certain books, actually depicted dialect, but people knew of him mostly as a dialect poet, and he wanted to be more than that. And so again, circling back to the idea of that caged bird, he was encaged in the perception that he would be a dialect poet when he believed that he was just an American poet. So what is he most known for today? See, instead of New York City, if we were in Ohio, people would know about his childhood relationship with Orville Wright. So I'm sure you've heard about Orville Wright. He was one of the brothers of the Wright brothers who invented the airplane. And also he was an innovative person. He had updates to the bicycle in the late 19th century. It turns out that Poulance Dunbar and Orville Wright were classmates at Central High School in Dayton, Ohio. And it was at a time when African Americans were only being integrated in high school classrooms, and Orville Wright and Poulance Dunbar hit it off so well. In fact, together they co-edited a newspaper called The Tattler for the Dayton community, particularly the African American Dayton community. What people don't know much about Orville Wright is that his father, Milton Wright, was an editor of a religious journal, and they were well read as a family. And they were experts in the printing press. And so prior to working with Poulance Dunbar, Orville Wright and his brother Wilbur actually had a printing press, and they would publish pamphlets and newsletters for the West Dayton community. And it was that expertise of Orville with the printing press and Poulance Dunbar aspiring to be a poet, they decided to join hands in an entrepreneurial way to publish The Dayton Tattler. And so that story, if you're in Ohio, they know much about those two, but that is the story that I've tried to tell in this biography. I hope you have a chance to look at it. Now, Dunbar was also quite exceptional in having, despite only a stone's throw from the end of slavery, he had access to the great politicians and celebrities of his time. And so aside from Orville Wright, who wasn't really famous at that moment, he is especially in history, but he was connected to Theodore Roosevelt. Theodore Roosevelt was the governor of New York. I guess that is relevant. And Theodore Roosevelt eventually, as you know, became president of the United States. And they had a close relationship and correspondence. And so you should read about that in here. He was also quite close to someone named Frederick Douglass, who was the legendary abolitionist and orator of the 19th century, one of the great statesmen of his time. And he was the mentee. Dunbar was a mentee of Frederick Douglass. Poulance Dunbar also had a close relationship with William Dean Howells, who was the great cultural arbiter of the late 19th century. He was the, in a way, the agent of Mark Twain, and he could make or break a literary career. And when Poulance Dunbar published Majors and Minors, William Dean Howells came across and said, this is the premier poet of our times. And in a way, it launched Paul Laurence Dunbar's career, for better or for worse, because he also said that he's a great dialect poet, right? And so that is something that he wrestled with. And so the thing that I hope is that people have a deeper understanding of Dunbar, given his 150th anniversary of his birth. And what I've been trying to do is to showcase his many gifts as a writer. So with that background, I'd like to read certain sections of this book that I think you'll enjoy. The first section is in the very beginning. So if you've had it, it's a long book. It'll take you a long time to read. It took me a long time to write. So this is on page 15. So if you can get to from 15 to 17 or so, that's good. But obviously, as you know, the crux of the story is in the beginning. And so what I tried to do was to capture the various streams of his life in this opening section. So this is the very opening paragraph, the very, very opening section of chapter one, which is called Broken Country. And it focuses on his parents, Matilda and Joshua, who were slaves, and they eventually were freed from slavery. And it was against the backdrop of the Civil War. Paul Laurence Dunbar was quite bright for a four-year-old. At this age, he was learning to read and write, a process his mother, Matilda, began before his formal schooling even started. As a child, he used a slate tablet on which he learned the typography, enunciation, and meaning of letters and words. Close to the end of his life, he recalled that his mother watered the seeds of his early literacy. My mother, who had no education except what she picked up herself, and who was generally conceded to be a very unusual woman, taught me to read when I was 4 years old. Matilda could have been deemed unusual for the host of reasons. Her indefatigable will at the end of the Civil War to flee her birthplace in Kentucky for a small town in Ohio, all the while being a single mother expecting her second child from her first husband. Her temperamental flashes, her hard-nosed protection of her family, her vulnerable acceptance of a troubled and troubling man in Joshua Dunbar, who became her second husband, Paul's father. Equally unusual was her educational resolve, which she shared with Joshua despite the strain in their marriage and the domestic malaise resulting from it. Both my father and herself were fond of books, Paul recalled, that he used to read to us as we sat around the fire at night. The semicircle of Paul and his older half-brothers, Robert and William Murphy, created the audience. Matilda's handwritten letters to Paul and her relatives proved that she commanded literacy, which legend says she accumulated over time, letter by letter, word by word, ranging from her access to her other school children to her forays into night school. According to Paul, both of his parents valued education. He asserted that his father even played the role of an instructor. Despite their domestic hard times, Matilda and Joshua still managed to bring themselves and their sons together, to huddle and cherish stories and language as a family trying to grasp what had been penned about their race or their times, about their town or their country, while continuing to understand one another. The stories Paul heard from his mother about the South, about how she survived and left Kentucky, prescribed his vision of the world as long as he lived with her. Here in the evening around the fireside, an early biographer wrote, was the environment of study, of song, cheer, and the lore and romance which had been the background of their forebears. Another wrote that from his father, Paul obtained a deeper sense of the ways of the South. The voices of Joshua, Matilda, and those friends who were former house slaves and field hands from southern plantations, and to whom Matilda introduced Paul, inflected the vernacular wisdom in the old plantation language, regaling him with stories entailing humor and pathos. Looking back, Paul attributed the tenor, the music, the ethos of his poetry about the lives of his parents, about their circle of friends to his memory of these voices. I have heard so many fireside tales of that simple, jolly, tuneful life. Down in the country districts of Kentucky, I've seen it all. But the journey of his parents, Joshua and Matilda, was far more complicated than merely a simple, jolly, tuneful life. Indeed, the story of Paul's life, of how his characteristic mind and heart evolved from childhood to adulthood and expressed themselves in his personal conduct or literary writings, must begin with the largely untold and difficult story of how his parents survived slavery in Kentucky and, as freed people, built their lives in Ohio, first independently, then together, then apart. Part of this story, particularly that early period about his father, once an artisanal slave in search of freedom, Paul himself recounted for the sake of his family's legacy and embellished on behalf of his literary craft. So, in my view, I try to harness the full Dunbar's life and of his parents in that section. And what I'd like to do now is to read to you a section about his time with the Library of Congress. So I remarked on the symbolism of the bird's cage, but his wife, Alice, at that time, she was aware of his own experience in the Library of Congress, and she actually likened the birdcage to being in the Library of Congress with those book stacks, and there wasn't any air conditioning in there. And so the bird's cage, according to Alice, referred to, as she called it, the iron grating of book stacks in the Library of Congress, where, as she put it again, the torrid sun poured its rays down into the courtyard of the library and heated the iron grilling of the book stacks until they were like prison bars in more senses than one. Dunbar worked in the Library of Congress from September 1897 through October 1898. And during this period, a series of illnesses cut short his employment there. So what had been a proverbial job to die for, it's something that he truly wanted, he was in a way actually dying working that job. And there are ways that Alice could have been overstating Dunbar's misery, but I do think there's a revealing story to be told about Dunbar at the Library of Congress. And so I'm gonna read that section to you. So Dunbar had spent quite a bit of time in England in 1897, and he was aspiring to have this job at the Library of Congress. So I'm gonna read that section for you. It's in the chapter 13 called East Coast Strivings. And so at this time, Paul Laurence Dunbar and Alice were just engaged and they're being weighed down by finances. And so he's restless. Finances weighed on Paul and Alice during their engagement. Among their discussions of writing and publishing opportunities, they also discussed fears and disagreements about making ends meet. An early clue to Paul's own preoccupation with finances came in the fall, right after his return from England. From the Manhattan port, he traveled to 33 Poplar Street in Brooklyn, the home of Victoria Earle Matthews, where Alice was staying. He had hoped to surprise Alice, but moments before he arrived, she had left for her relatives in West Medford, Massachusetts. He considered following her, but changed his mind. "I feel like starting right on for Boston today, but this is nonsense," he wrote Alice. "We cannot live on love, so I must stay here and make something that we can live on." A month later, in September, Paul wrote to Alice from Washington, D.C., where he was visiting friends, including Henry Baker and Louis Douglas, Frederick Douglass's son. September 27, 1897 was the date when Paul would learn whether he had won a coveted job. Incidentally, 2 months earlier, in the middle of July, he had received an uplifting letter from Colonel Robert Greene Ingersoll, an influential Civil War veteran and attorney from New York, and revered by American poets as esteemed as Walt Whitman. Ingersoll revealed in his letter that a remarkable new era in the history of the Library of Congress had just begun. "My dear Dunbar," he began his letter, "the other day John Russell Young was appointed librarian at Washington. I know Mr. Young well, and it may be that I could induce him to give you a place. I will try. It seems to me that the president would like to recognize your ability in some way. I will see if the library fails, what can be done in that direction. Do not become disheartened. You have already succeeded. Be true to yourself. You have genius, that is enough. Better crusts and rags with genius than feasts and robes without. Be true to the inward light. I will write to Mr. Young today. I hope you are well and hopeful. I remain yours truly, R.G. Ingersoll." By the time Paul received this letter, Ingersoll's admiration for him was well established. Ingersoll was an acquaintance of Henry Toby, who had sent the colonel a copy of Majors and Minors. Henry Toby was Dunbar's patron. "I do not profess to be literary, but I think probably have ordinary human feeling and common sense, and I would like to read over the poems I have marked, which I think unusual," Toby wrote in April 1896. "If after reading them you feel the same way, it would be great consideration to Mr. Dunbar in his poverty and obscurity if you would write a letter of commendation." Eventually, Ingersoll did write back enthusiastically. "Some of them, these poems, are really wonderful, full of poetry and philosophy," he said. "I'm astonished at their depth and subtlety. Dunbar is a thinker." Convinced that, as well, that the poet was a genius, Ingersoll asked, "Now, I ask what can be done for him. I would like to help." Ingersoll's reverence for Paul informed his latest intrigue in assisting Paul's application for a position in the Library of Congress. Ingersoll kept his word. On July 5th, he sent a letter to John Russell Young, just appointed the 7th Librarian of Congress, on Paul's behalf. Ingersoll had already been in touch with Young, congratulating him on winning the librarianship, and he used his initial contact to request a favor. He summarized Paul's story, his parents' enslavement, his public schooling, and the literary promise of Major and Minors, whose poems are wonderful, show great thought and great subjects, and are intense, subtle, passionate, poetic, are filled with touches of pathos, of joy, or real humor. He then made this request. "Dunbar is now in England. He's coming home. He, of course, is poor. He's crazy to read, to be in the company of books. Could you give this young fellow a place in the library?" When Paul returned to America, he also wrote to Young, hoping to call upon you with the letter of our common friend, Colonel Ingersoll. In 1897, President McKinley had appointed Young Librarian of Congress precisely because his predecessor, Ainsworth Rand Spofford, according to Library Journal, was not able to keep in touch with the modern developments of library organization or practice. When the library needed to fulfill its manifest destiny of becoming in name as it was, in fact, the National Library, the former managing editor of Horace Greeley's The Tribune and later contributor to the New York Herald, Young was an eventual companion to a previous president, Ulysses S. Grant, who ended up floating his name to McKinley. In his new role as head of the library, Young was poised to open its new building on November 1st, with the permission to increase the staffing from 42 to 108, to be distributed among such areas as the reading room, copyright office, law library, periodical department, cataloging department, music department, manuscripts department, art gallery, and hall of charts department. Maps. The library's call for workers attracted thousands of applications for junior positions that paid on average $60 per month, while Young personally sought out the best candidates for the most senior administrative roles. The growth of the Library of Congress at the outset of Young's tenure made Paul hopeful that Ingersoll's intervention on his behalf would succeed. Initially, Ingersoll's letter did not inspire Paul's optimism. When he wrote to his mother about it, he remarked, as if schooled well by repeated rejections from editors and publishers, "This letter is good, but don't hope too much from it," he wrote. "We've been disappointed as often." Fortunately for Paul, in the end, his pessimism was unwarranted. Paul did win a job as assistant librarian in the Library of Congress. Not only did he have a legitimate post in the magisterial library, the concentration of such distinguished men on his literary potential and professional progress revealed the high regard this young man, born from slaves, was beginning to enjoy in the halls of the United States government. The last section I'd like to read from us, if that's all right, and then I would love to entertain your questions, is from the final chapter of my book. It's called Waiting in Loafing Holt, right? And that was, you know, the word loafing that comes from Whitman. You know, he says in Leaves of Grass, "Let's loaf on the grass," right? And so it was a place where Dunbar loafed. It was his personal library. And I show in this chapter that he gravitated to the great minds of literature in this extensive library that he built over time and collected here. This is the second floor study of his home in Dayton, and that's where he died on February 9th, 1906. So if you can imagine, he died in that space. So in the book, I describe the nature of this house in great detail. I skip some of this information and go into the nature of his library. And through it, I intersperse a poem as part of my characterization of this library. It's remarkable to see this is on page 428. That's a long time for it, yes, but oh boy. The Dayton home turned out to be a resting place for Paul's weakening body. So at this time he was sick and he was deteriorating, if you will. To try and maintain some fitness during his life of largely sedentary work and physical frailty, he owned a 5-pound dumbbell for arm exercises. The house was the perfect place for his personal library, for the many books sustaining his mind. The books spanned the gamut of his interests as a writer and intellectual. They arrived by way of a host of people ranging from the famous to the obscure, from random authors and fans to acquaintances intimate and distant. They included not only his own books, but also those that once belonged to Alice, particularly the ones emphasizing schooling and pedagogy. Alice was a teacher, and by this time they were separated in their marriage. Other books belonged to his mother, Matilda, who also resided in the home. Books were scattered across the house, in the sitting room with the fireplace, on shelves in the bedrooms, and of course, in the glass front bookcase on the wooden bookshelf, on and inside the desk, and inside the closet of his second floor study, which had come to be called Loafing Holt. In his 1905 book, Lyrics of Sunshine and Shadow, Paul included a poem, At Loafing Holt, which conveyed the physical and spiritual respite his study, this silvern, cool retreat afforded. The poem opens, "Since I left the city's heat for this silvern, cool retreat, high upon the hillside here, where the air is clean and clear, I have lost the urban ways." Paul had accumulated a who's who of political authors in his library. He had collected the writings of Booker T. Washington, all rendered crystal clear the Tuskegee leader's controversial modern vision of racial uplift. He also owned the two 1904 volumes of addresses and state papers given to him by Theodore Roosevelt. Washington and Roosevelt also happened to personally inscribe these books to him with their compliments. A series of books were given and inscribed by Paul's literary friends, There was Driftwood, the 1890 book of poems by William Frimer, sent to him with good wishes. There was Tempe Vale and other poems, an 1888 collection by James Newton Matthews, provided with admiration and esteem of his friend. Also, a slew of books he kept as gifts from authors who inscribed impressions of their respect for his work. During his time, he was a magnet for personalized editions from fellow rising or accomplished poets, men and women. Mary Berry Chapman, M.A. Merritt Kramer, Caroline Dandridge, Andrew Downing, Yurita Holmes, Edward Hume, Elizabeth Johnston, Benjamin Franklin Leggett, William Lloyd, James McGirt. He also possessed such editions from writers of fiction and nonfiction, including H.S. Cunningham and Horace Judson Rollin. Thumbing through the books brought Paul much peace of mind in his peaceful home. Mine are calm and tranquil days. Sloping lawns of green are mine. Cluster treasures of the vine, long forgotten plants I know, where the best wild berries grow, where the greens and grasses sprout, when the elders blossom out. Young's 1903 fairy tale Phantasma captured the tenor and praise of writers who sent their books to Paul. To the genial and brilliant poet, Mr. Paul Laurence Dunbar, who has added glory to his race and the literature of his country with the homage and admiration of James Carlton Young. Some acquaintances were not authors sent to him, some acquaintances who were not authors sent him books anyway. Publishers Frank Dodd sent his regards in Hamilton Wright Mabie's In a Forest of Arden, which was published by Dodd Mead in 1899. Victoria Earle Matthews signed a copy of Ralph Waldo Emerson's 1847 poems. And Major James Burton Pond signed a copy of Henry Ward Beecher's 1887, A Summer in England, the lectures and sermons Beecher delivered in England in the summer of 1886 and edited by Major Pond himself. The bulk of Paul's library featured books that had stood or seemed bound to stand the test of time. At the very least, they were popular during his own time. These were the books he could read again and again over the course of the day. Now I am grown weather-wise with the love of winds and skies. Mine the song whose soft refrain is the sigh of summer rain. Seek you where the woods are cool, would you know the shady pool, where throughout the lazy day speckled beauties drowse or play? Ever since his secondary education, Paul had gravitated to classical literature. Unsurprisingly, he possessed editions of Virgil's Aeneid, along with manuals of Greek and Roman mythology, translated orations of Cicero and of the Rubaiyat of Omar Khayyam, not to mention John Bunyan's 1678 Pilgrim's Progress. He was a collector of the best poetry from both sides of the Atlantic. His American poets were headlined by the various writings of James Whitcomb Riley, followed by Oliver Wendell Holmes Sr. and James Russell Lowell, while his English poets were William Shakespeare, Robert Burns, Alfred Lord Tennyson, John Keats, and George Herbert. Paul's writers of short fiction and the novel likewise span the West. Among the Americans, Washington Irving was his favorite, with multiple copies of his books. And then there was Nathaniel Hawthorne, Edith Wharton, Frank Norris, Stephen Crane, Ruth McHenry Stewart. Regarding the writers from Europe, he owned quite a few books by Rudyard Kipling, Emile Zola, Alexander Dumas, and Arthur Conan Doyle rounded out the list. Finally, he possessed more books by the Scottish philosopher Thomas Carlyle than by any other author. He also owned books by the Scottish historical novelist Sir Walter Scott, his autobiography, English philosopher Herbert Spencer, and his very own William Dean Howells, the book Italian Journeys, the 1867 book on being an American consul, in Venice. Would you find rest in or peace, sorrow's permanent release? Leave the city grim and gray. Come with me, ah, come away. Paul owned a considerable library of books by or about African Americans. Above all, he had several books by Booker T. Washington, all released in the year 1900, A New Negro for a New Century, Sowing and Reaping, and The Future of the American Negro. Frederick Douglass had inscribed an 1893 edition of his third autobiography, The Life and Times of Frederick Douglass, first published in 1881, then revised in an 1892 reprint, to his dear young poet and friend, a man whom I hope great things. A formidable literary contemporary of his, Charles Chestnut, held a spot on his shelves with the books of 1899, The Conjure Woman and The Wife of His Youth. Paul also owned Imperium and Imperial, the 1899 novel of a lesser known contemporary, Sutton Griggs. There were the books of African-American acquaintances, such as Alexander Crummell's 1891 publication of Addresses and Discourses, Africa and America, and Victoria Earle Matthews' 1893 story founded on real life, Aunt Lindy. There were the volumes by African-American poets of the 19th century, George Marion McClellan, Albury Alson Whitman, Francis Ellen Watkins Harper, Joseph Seaman Cotton Sr., Aaron Belford Thompson. Interspersed among this literature were remarkable histories of African American life. Books on the African Methodist Episcopal Church, the American Sons of Protection for unfairly taxed African American citizens in Dayton, legislative documents or conference proceedings on the politics of race relations in North Carolina and South Carolina, and African American soldiers of the Civil War, which is what his father was. Do you fear the winter chill, deeps of snow upon the hill? 'Tis a mantle kind and warm, shielding tender shoots from harm. Beyond his evident erudition in Western literature and history, Paul's library veered into topics that presumably transcended the poet's natural base of literary knowledge. Truth be told, the autodidactic knowledge of a poor Dayton poet born to former slaves. One book was a background in natural philosophy. Another focused on the American copyright enactments from the late 18th century to the turn of the century, 20th century. A third book exhibited the history of Oriental and classical ancient literature. Another recorded the life of Frederick the Great, the mid-18th century king of Prussia, and several more covered, respectively, the mental philosophy of intellect, sensibilities, and willpower, the natural history of caves, and the latest dietetic and medicinal approaches to disease. The swath of these books likely overlap with Alice's own. Technical and rudimentary textbooks attended to English grammar, elocution and rhyming, algebra and arithmetic, on learning music and rhyming, the lexicon of foreign languages, and the taking of entrance examinations for schools to train teachers. Some contain Alice's own notations of the place and time of her work as a teacher in Brooklyn in 1897. If not Alice's, then these books possibly could have been those that Paul accumulated along the way in his own primary and secondary education, and afterward his autodidactic learning of literature and language. There's one book, Joseph Ray and Ellie Tappan's 1868 Treatise on Geometry and Trigonometry, bore Paul's own inscription, Central High School, with his marginalia throughout. Do you dread the ice-clad streams? They are mirrors for your dreams. Here's a rouse when summer's past to the raging winter's blast. Let him roar and let him rout. We are armored for the bout. How the logs are glowing, see? Who sings louder, they or he? Could the city be more gay? Burn your bridges, come away. Centered on the floor of Loafing Holt was a hand-woven Navajo blanket, serving as a rug
with large horizontal sawtooth diamonds of gray, red, brown, and orange triangles against a red background. He purchased it in April 1900 during his convalescence in Colorado. On a wall hung his framed Central High School diploma, individually framed portraits of friends and acquaintances, such as fellow writers and artists of his time, congested the top of his walnut desk and of his doored bookcases. Between and among colorful mugs, wine glasses, teacups, trinkets, figurines, and personal artifacts, a Morris chair enabled him to recline in solitary reflection, his hand not frequently balancing a cherished pipe among his fingers. A green tufted daybed, which doubled as extra storage underneath, lay a few feet away and was comfortable for long napping or resting. He also took solace in his black and gold metal Remington, standard typewriter number 6, which he used on the desks in his study or his bedroom for composing literature, but also for writing letters of correspondence. And Matilda could stay nearby in a smaller though well-furnished bedroom on the same floor. All right, thank you. So I guess, I wonder if you have any questions about anything I've read or just anything in general? Yes.
I know James Carruthers lived to regret having written in dialect. He writes about that in his memoir. Did Paul Laurence Dunbar put in print, "I wish I had never used that language," or he didn't live long enough to sort of see the perspective of it?
He did. In fact, in a letter of correspondence, he remarks on William Dean Howells. As I mentioned, William Howells was a person who especially launched his career. And there was a phrase that he used in a letter saying that he regretted the dictum, as he put it, that William Howells had imposed on his dialect verse, mm-hmm. In terms of its value. And there was a way in which, as he was in England and he was reflecting on his newfound success, that he was at risk of actually being pigeonholed, as it were, right? And so he was concerned about that, but by the same token, he was remarkably in favor of the kind of commercial support that Howells provided, and they were rather friendly nonetheless in their writings. And I'm inclined to say that William Howells genuinely wanted to help him, as Howells helped many writers. Dunbar himself was just rather conflicted mm-hmm. on what this meant for his life and career.
Can I say something?
Yes, please.
Well, it's a shame if he was ashamed of having done that. Because when I was a little girl, I grew up in Pennsylvania, which is next to Ohio, and we certainly did not speak dialect, but we loved reading and saying his poems because we just loved to think of the dialect and the life that had been. Mm-hmm. I'm just sorry that he felt that it was holding him back, but he loved it so.
Yeah, and you know what? I think both things can be true. And there were moments when he did embrace and speak this poetry into being. He was not only a writer, but he performed his poetry quite a bit. And he recited his poems in dialect. And people revered listening to him read his poems in dialect. So there are ways in which I would just say that he had a rather conflicted relationship to his work, which is normal. He is an extraordinary talent, but he was also a normal human being, and he just kind of vacillated between, on the one hand, he would be in England reading his poems and people would enjoy it, but at the same time, he would meditate on, well, would they be so excited on, for example, his poem on At Lofenholt? You heard that. Is that the kind that would bring people out of their chairs, or would they enjoy more the kinds of poems that made people kind of envision the life that no longer existed of slaves? And I think it's also true that people loved reading and memorizing his poems, reciting his poems. He often wrote in lyrics, so these were poems that were graspable, they were easy to memorize, and there are ways that people read these poems in churches, in schools, and all the aspects of African-American life, but also beyond that, I have to say that there was this one experience I had when I went to, there's a museum devoted to Orville Wright, as well as to Paul Laurence Dunbar, and the Dayton National Heritage Aviation Foundation would give a special patch to young people, particularly school-aged children, if they could recite a poem by Paul Laurence Dunbar. And I remember showing up, I think that was a time when I didn't have an iPhone, and so I couldn't like record, and I'm not sure if I would record a stranger in that way anyway, but it was a marvelous moment. And as I've talked about Dunbar and gone across the country to talk about his work, there are many people who say that they remember, you know, reciting his poems and enjoying it, it being a part of their lives. I think that's true. I think the thing I had to do in this biography was be faithful to the historical record and to be honest about how he thought about it, and but also the meaning of his work. Yes.
So I wondered how you knew what he had in his library.
Yes. Okay. And so it's okay for me to get into the weeds. And so I visited what's called it's his home in Dayton. It's the place that he actually purchased towards the end of his life. And so obviously you have a chance to tour that facility. If you haven't gone there, I recommend it. You see things firsthand. His shoes were there. Mm-hmm. And of course, as you could recall, I had my measuring tape to see how long it was. Could I ascertain how tall he was? Mm-hmm. Yeah, measured his clothes. He had a cane there, which inside there was a flask so that he could drink alcohol, because he was suffering from tuberculosis, and people at that time drank alcohol in order to, as a salve for their illness. And so I was there talking with certain officials who superintended the home, and they actually had a full inventory of all the books in that library. Mm-hmm. And it just so happened that I was talking to a gentleman, I actually acknowledged him in the book, either in a footnote or in the epilogue of some sort. And it was just a remarkable opportunity to go through all of these books in his library. And then of course, as well, the house is well preserved. And so you can go in and actually see firsthand these books. The thing that I tried to do in this section that I read to you is to build some coherence in his library, to indicate what were the various categories of books that he had. What did it mean that he had multiple copies of one author's production? What did it mean that he had a variety of inscriptions in these books? And what did that say about his relationship to his contemporaries? So I just wanted to illustrate as best I could the full expanse of his intellectual imagination and the kind of resources that he had, particularly towards the end of his life. Yes?
You mentioned that he was a big fan of poets and prose of ancient Rome. And given that he used the bird metaphor and used a style that was very lyrical, do you know if he was a reader of Catullus, who I think also was known for, you know, reading his poetry and engaging people in that way?
Yeah, I think that's an insightful question. You know, one thing that I did in this book, and it's in one of the early chapters, particularly my talk about his middle school education, also his secondary school education, was the prominence of classical literature in that curriculum. And so I was able to recreate the kinds of works that he had read, and he was very much interested in Greek history, and I lay out indeed how he's part of a generation, especially of African Americans at the turn of the 20th century. You know, Scarborough is another person, and later on writers of the Harlem Renaissance who studied this kind of work rather closely. What this avails, if I may, and in a way, because this is a biography, I'm not able to do full close reads of his work, but you can actually examine the various tropes of his attention to Western intellectual and cultural traditions in there. And so I would certainly encourage you to look at the section where I talk about his high school education, and you can see those allusions in his poetry. Yeah.
Thank you.
Was he published by mainstream publishers? I mean, how unusual was that for an African American?
Yeah, so I would say that I alluded to Dodd and Mead and Company.
Yeah, sure.
I would regard that as a
yes.
mainstream
yeah.
Publisher. There was also Lippincott, who had published Lippincott's magazine.
Mm-hmm.
He had published in there. He was one of the rare African Americans in the late 19th century who published in these mainstream
mm-hmm.
venues.
Yeah.
In fact, I illustrate in the book that as a result, he had a remarkable impact, not only in terms of these standard mainstream publishers I mentioned, but in syndication. So he syndicated his poems across many periodicals, if I may put it that way. He published a lot of individual poems in newspapers. And so that increased the impact of his work. There was very much at that time a rise of what's called black periodicals. These were newspapers that were published by African American learned societies, and they knew of Paul Laurence Dunbar, but that wasn't especially where he published his work. He actually transcended that group of publishers.
I have a couple of questions, actually. You mentioned Toni Morrison. Isn't there a poem, and was that in kind of praise of him? When does the cage bird fly, or something? Or does Toni Morrison have a?
Yeah.
No. But you might be thinking about Maya Angelou.
Maya Angelou.
Yeah, that's right. And so she published an autobiography called "I Know Why the Cage Bird Sings."
Thanks. Okay.
Yes.
So a couple of questions. Was there any presidential recognition of? Who was the president at the time, and was there?
So, especially when he responded, it was a Theodore Roosevelt. Yeah.
Sure.
Yeah. So, was there presidential recognition? So, I would say that beyond the letters of correspondence, where they recognized his work, he was also invited to, presidential inaugurations, and so I do touch on that in here. And I think, as I alluded to in my discussion of the Library of Congress, he was in contact with a variety of officials in the government, and in a way, it illustrated his great reach, despite coming from humble beginnings, if I may put it that way. And he was someone who ultimately was widely appreciated. In fact, one of the campaign songs of Theodore Roosevelt, I indicate, actually was anchored to verse that Dunbar had written for him. And so, yes, there was a relationship between him and those high officials.
Ironically, you mentioned Theodore Roosevelt, who was supposed to be racist because they took his statue down, but yet he had the first African-American for dinner at the...
That's right. He had Booker T. Washington.
Washington.
But, that's an interesting point, because I do touch on that in this book. It's interesting that, he actually had a relationship with Paul Laurence Dunbar that was stronger even before that. Paul Laurence Dunbar actually could have been the first African American invited to dinner at the White House, but it never came to pass. And so I will say that as it played out, Booker T. Washington turned out to be that individual.
When was the Poet Laureate assigned for the country?
I'm not sure, but just to recuperate your question. He was called the poet laureate of his race. That was actually an idiomatic phrase in newspapers. So it wasn't poet laureate in the official sense that you have in relation to, what you would find in various countries or in this country.
De facto.
Yeah. But he was a de facto poet laureate of the black race, as it was put. And so that was something he wrote. Yes.
A question from the live stream. When Dunbar writes about slavery, he often depicts kindly and bemused masters. Was
mm-hmm.
that what his parents experienced?
Mm-hmm.
It seems Frederick Douglass and others depict slavery and masters rather differently. Was there pressure for him to depict slavery in this way?
That's a great question. And one of the things that's occurred over the 20th century, as people look back on Dunbar's life and work, there were these kinds of caricatures of African Americans and of those who owned them, right, that played into certain stereotypes. But what's also true is that he humanized these individuals or illustrated their complexity in ways that were not seen in some of his contemporaries. And so you had George Washington Cable, you had Joel Chandler Harris, you had James Whitcomb Riley. They also wrote in dialect. They also characterized African Americans in certain ways in their literary works. Dunbar, if you're not careful, you would think that it's the same as that genre, but in certain ways, there were a lot of ironies that he would illustrate. There were various moments when African Americans were empowered in ways beyond the proportion that was accorded them in American literature at that time. And he also showed how certain white masters and mistresses, as they were called at that time, were wrestling with the idea of owning slaves, or they were wrestling with the end of slavery. He illustrated a complexity of their lives that was not seen quite often. I think the only other person who probably depicted them with comparable complexity was Charles Chestnut. Yes.
What did you do with Alice's version of the story? Which is some, right? I had no idea how much of her correspondence survived and how much of her diary survived. Did you sometimes find a direct contradiction between the two versions of what happened that day?
Which day?
Oh, no, any day.
I'm
saying, is there a random day where, like, she's absolutely insistent that he did X and he's absolutely insistent that he did Y?
Yeah, that's right. So there were many days in their life and it went up and down.
Yeah.
You know, yeah, so I looked closely at her letters to him. I looked at his letters to her. And one of the challenges, obviously, of writing a biography is making sure that everything lines up. And so there are things behind the scenes in the footnotes that you're trying to reconcile. I would say that things lined up very well. I'll also say that I did draw upon, and I talk about this in the epilogue, her own diary and writings, her reflections on being with Dunbar, but also his value after he died. I think one thing that's also true is that I talk about his relationship with someone named Rebecca Baldwin. That was his first major, I guess, girlfriend, or you put it that way. And some of the kinds of the oscillations that he went through in his emotional health and also his depression, there were some early diagnoses of that in that correspondence, and that played, those ideas played themselves out in his relationship with Alice. And so I tried to draw a fuller arc of his inner life, if you will, beyond what we have in his relationship with Alice. Yes, please.
How old was he when he died?
So he died.
Is that surprising to him? Or?
Right, and so he died around the age of 33, so he didn't reach his 34th. Yes, and so he died young in his early. He did a lot. It's a very long book about a short life. Yeah, I remember somebody said that in a book review. Yes, so imagine if he lived until he was in his 70s or 80s, that would be a two-volume book.
Was he aware that he
himself
was
ill? Yes, that's right. And so as I alluded to, he tried to cope by drinking alcohol. As a result, he by many accounts became an alcoholic, it was called. And that affected his life. That affected, he would show up to poetry readings drunk. He would be especially violent in the home as a result. But nonetheless, he was someone by his early 30s was prodigious. He published, I have in my data here, 14 books of poetry, 4 collections of short stories, 4 novels, many essays. He could have continued on and on. He just had that robust literary imagination. So it's unfortunate that he died young, but there was still a lot to work with.
Craig, ask one more question.
Yep, you just one
more question. Okay. Was he writing anything religious? Did he have a religion? Did he have any kind of spiritual kind of?
Yes, and so so it turns out that he did attend an American Methodist Episcopal Church in his early years, probably before he became a teenager. And his first novel, The Young Paul, is actually, as I referred to before, kind of a spiritual autobiography. It talks about, you know, a protagonist who's grappling with his spirituality and grappling with his family. And so it indicates some of Dunbar's own confusion about spirituality and his relationship to religion. So I think that is the centerpiece of his thinking on that.
Dr. Jared, thank you so much.